gentlemen, welcome aboard your unvoiced character journey. Please note that the writer has turned on the inconsequential sign. If you haven't done so, please stow your emotional baggage underneath the seat in front of you, or in the overhead bins provided, or so deep inside of you that your eyes remain blank. We remind you that, for you, this is a non-dialogue flight. Tampering with, adding to, or fleshing out the script is, of course, prohibited. Please refrain from upstaging the main characters in any way. If you are seated in an emergency exit row, please leave that seat immediately. That's far too much action for you to be involved in. Your crew will be coming by with your thinly developed backstory shortly after takeoff. We know you have a choice when you travel, and we thank you for your commitment to maintaining your one-dimensional selves.
Okay, case 89435, please step forward.
Yes, Your Honor.
Please state your name for the record.
Tooth Fairy.
Okay, Miss Tooth.
Sorry, so it's not first name Tooth, last name Fairy.
That's what I have here in my records.
Yes, that's incorrect. It's just one name, Tooth Fairy. It's like Madonna, but two words.
Okay, so Ms. Tooth Fairy.
That's right, okay. Yes.
All right, and you are here today to contest a parking citation, is that correct?
Yes.
All right, you have a parking ticket on Kushner Street where you parked for more than the allowed 10 minutes in a loading zone.
Right. Your Honor, if I may, this is so unfair. Ever since the city privatized street parking, I've run into these issues. You see, there was a seven-year-old on the sixth floor of a high-rise apartment building, and he lost his tooth, so I had to go up there and had to get
it. First of all, please, why are you driving when you have wings?
Sir, look at me. I'm the size of a fingernail. I mean, you think I can just fly when I have to lug a quarter that is, forgive me, the size of my body up six flights of stairs? My back is killing me, and my health insurance won't cover it. They say it's a pre-existing condition because I guess I've been around for eternity or whatever.
It says here that you were parked there for over 2 hours. Care to explain? Ms. Tooth Fairy.
I don't think I should have to answer that.
What were you doing for those 2 hours, ma'am?
Hey, you can't ask me that. That's my own private business as a private citizen.
Okay. It's very simple. You broke the rules, you pay.
I can't afford to pay. I can't afford to pay this. I have no money. No money. I have teeth. I have stacks and stacks of human teeth. I lose money. I mean, I give people money for their teeth. So, okay, here's the thing. I got some bad advice, right? We all have. I have a cousin named Donnie, and he assured me that teeth would be trading at the same rate as gold on the commodities market by now. But then, of course, the ivory trade ruined it for everybody.
Look,
and you know, excuse me. You know what else? Do you know what else? In Norway?
In Norway.
Yeah, in Norway, I know fairies who get 6 weeks off a year. Okay, I am not one of those work one day a year holiday icons. I mean, I am on call 24 hours a day.
Okay,
I feel
Ms. Tooth Fairy,
like I'm
losing
my
down.
Mind.
Please pull yourself together.
Okay.
I don't see how any of this sob story is relevant to the fact that you broke the law.
Can I pay for this ticket in teeth?
Sure.
Do you chronically look for adventure? Do you have a relentless urge to travel to a fantasy land, losing the respect of your loved ones because you're continually fleeing reality, always looking for your happily ever after? At last, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. Ask your doctor about AdventureSil and find out if it could be right for you. Start living your most grounded life today.
Okay. All right. Welcome, everyone, to Partners of Adults Who Had Life-Changing Adventures as Children. I'm Jeff, husband to Wendy Darling.
Hi, Jeff. You are loved and you are interesting.
All right, thanks. Ted, do you want to?
Sure, yeah. I am Ted. Thanks for having me. I am married to Dorothy. Hi, Ted. You are loved and you are interesting.
Thanks. And I see some new faces here this week.
Yeah, hi. Thanks. I'm Martha. I'm married to Alice. So, you know, Wonderland.
Oof.
Yikes.
Yeah. Hi, Martha. You are loved and you are interesting.
All right. Thank you guys and girls for coming. Let's get started. Does anybody have anything this week they'd like to share?
Yes,
yeah,
please.
Yeah. Ted, go ahead.
Yeah. So Dorothy has really crossed the line. I mean, she's always gone on and on about Oz, and that's fine. I mean, I don't love it, but it's fine. Okay, so we put in a new driveway. Last week, I go to work. I come home. Come to find out, she's painted it. Guess what color?
No.
No, please, guess what color?
Yellow.
That's right, yellow.
Oh.
We now have a goddamn yellow driveway. It's the eyesore of the neighborhood. Anyway, that's it.
You are loved and you are interesting.
Thanks for sharing, Ted. Thanks a lot. That's real tough stuff.
Yeah. Can I go next,
please? Yes, of course.
Thanks. God, I'm so glad I found you guys. I didn't know where else to turn because Alice, she went down the rabbit hole when she was just this little girl, you know, and in many ways, I don't think that she ever really fully came back. Mm. And it used to be just this dreamy, like distant thing in her eyes. Like, okay, so we'd be on the sofa of a Tuesday watching The Voice, and then bam, she's down the rabbit hole. I could see the swirls in her pupils, and that was, you know, that was one thing. But now it has developed. It's much more like sleepwalking. She kidnapped the boy from next door's pet rabbit, kept asking it for the time. We're stuck in traffic, ooh, and she spies a manhole across the road. She jumps out of the car. She crosses lanes of traffic, wrenches open the manhole, dives down into it, into the sewer. It's disgusting.
It's gross.
It's disgusting. She, who? She invited a homeless gentleman into our house, gave him all of my hats to wear, and I found them having a tea party with my Christmas china. I didn't know this man. I didn't feel safe in my own home. So, yes, I have been crushing an adventure sill and putting it into her smoothie in the morning just so that I can have a peaceful day.
Hi, I'm Wendy Moira Angela Darling, and I started taking Adventurcell when I had just about enough of Neverland, thank you. I was more than ready to grow up. One pill, twice daily, and my life has completely turned around. I run a company and wear pantsuits. My dry cleaner knows me, and I haven't been on a pirate ship or spoken to a mermaid in years. With Adventurcell, I can do the things in my life that I need to get done.
Adventurcell is not necessarily for everyone. Side effects include feelings of complacency, rejection of imaginary characters, depression, anal leakage, and lack of whimsy.
Adventurcell, grow up.
So, a couple of years ago, I was at a bar with some girlfriends, and we were sitting there and we were having a drink, and I sort of felt like someone was looking at me, how you can kind of sense it. And I turned around and I made eye contact with this boy, a kid, a teenager, and he was looking at me very intensely. He smiled and I smiled back. I was being polite. And he made a beeline for me. We started talking. And, I do. So, quick note about me. I avoid confrontation at all costs. I can't. Difficult conversations with people about things that make me uncomfortable or behavior that makes me uncomfortable. I'm just like, hey, don't worry about it. Let's not do it. So I don't have those confrontations generally. And so this kid is talking to me. We're talking, and he, you know, finds out my name, and he's saying, "Rosaline, you're so beautiful. You're the most beautiful woman I've ever seen." And you know, I'm like, oh, that's nice. but I do try to make it clear to him that I'm not interested romantically, obviously. And that's that. And then things Well, things started to get a little weird. I started seeing him everywhere. I would run into him at the grocery store or at the coffee shop where I worked. On my morning run, he just kind of popped up everywhere. And I still never said anything to him about it. Never had a confrontation. Never discussed it with him. And one night, I woke up and I looked out my bedroom window, and he was standing underneath my balcony. And I was like, "Yikes! Well, he's underneath my balcony. How did he find out where I lived?" And I don't know. I mean, but you know, kids and computers and Google, whatever. Anyway, the point is, I saw him there, and while I was a little worried, I think I mostly wrote it off as a kid with a crush. It seemed harmless. He just seemed, I've been lovesick before. I can empathize with where he was coming from. So I never said anything to him about it. He showed up under my balcony every night that week, calling my name, "Rosaline, Rosaline, I love you. I love you. You're so beautiful." And I just sort of didn't do anything about it. And then it stopped. He stopped. He was gone. I didn't see him anymore. He was no longer at the grocery store, no longer at the coffee shop. I don't know what happened, but I was relieved. And life went on as usual. And then one day I came into my work at the coffee shop, and there was a woman there, a customer. She was reading the newspaper. She called me over and she said, "Did you hear about this?" And I said, "Hear about what?" And she said, "A couple of teenagers just did this suicide pact thing." And I said, "Oh God, that's terrible." And then she read their names, and she read his name, Romeo. And I started replaying in my head all of the behavior that I wrote off as just a kid with a crush. I started replaying it all in my head, and I started seeing it as not just a kid with a crush. I saw it for the obsessiveness that it was showing. Like, I started thinking about how he acted and how it wasn't harmless, and how I knew that in some way. Like, I knew there was something dangerous about the intensity with which he pursued his love or his feelings for me, and I never said anything to him about it. I never had that confrontation with him, and I feel like we need to have those conversations with our sons and our brothers and our friends, the men in our lives, and tell them, show them what love looks like. Love is not possession. And it's not obsession, and it's not showing up under people's balconies and calling to them in the middle of the night. It's love is kindness, and it's respect, and it's listening. And I feel like I'm complicit in some way in what happened with Romeo and Juliet. If I had had that confrontation, that difficult conversation with Romeo, then I feel like he and Juliet might still be alive today.
Alrighty, roo-hoo, y'all. You all know how speed dating works. When you hear the bell, you move on to the next table and you be your most charming selves. Good luck out there. On your marks, get set, date.
Hi. So, Big Bad Wolf here. A couple of facts about me. I'm a foodie. Is what I am. I love taking long walks through the wood, although I haven't been able to really do much of that lately because I've been sort of recovering from a like an involuntary surgery. It's a really funny story. I ate a grandma.
Oh, well, hello there. You look beautiful. Me, I'm Pinocchio, Italian. And a couple things about me. Well, I am a real boy, but I don't have a birth mother. What? I'm a bit of a gambler, but it's not a problem. My best friends are animals. And Well, as far as the bedroom is concerned, let's just say I have a lot to offer. Ow! Ow! My nose!
We're the three little pigs.
Joey.
Zoe.
Dwayne.
We don't know how to be alone.
So we go on all our dates together.
And if this goes well, you'll have three spouses. One for talking.
One for cleaning.
And one for fun.
Mr. Claus, Mrs. Claus, I'm so glad to have both of you here. Couples therapy can be very challenging and even a little scary.
And expensive.
Okay, thank you. And but, you know, it's important to know that it can help harbor intimacy and help build new stories.
Mm-hmm.
I should say before we start that I am such a big fan of the work that both of you do for children. Oh, thank you.
Both of us do. That's a laugh.
Jesus. Carol.
What?
Okay. What? Okay, hey.
Can you keep it a little...
Hey, listen. Let's slow down. Let's start again. Why do you think you guys are here?
Well, go ahead.
Please?
No.
Go.
Okay. I guess I'll go first. We're here because Carol wanted to stop crying all the time.
Wow, Chris.
Well,
wow. Is that what you think it is?
Literally, that's what you said, that you were constantly crying.
I didn't say that I was crying all of the time. I said that I was experiencing a sadness.
Okay, right. And so, anyway, can you fix her?
Oh, okay. Hey, let's focus on just listening to each other. Let's start again. Carol?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus? Why do you think you're here?
Okay, so when Chris and I first got together, I was so young, and I felt like it was my duty to be supportive of him. You know, that's what wives did at that time. So I did all of the wish list receiving, constantly updating his naughty and nice lists. I did all the hiring and the firing of the elves, just everything.
I'm sorry, did you not like building your dream house at the North Pole?
It has nothing to do with that, Chris.
You guys seem to have enjoyed that.
Yeah.
Chris, you will get your turn to speak, I promise, but it's Carol's turn right now.
Thank you.
Carol, please, you're doing great.
Thanks. Okay, anyway, and now I feel like it's just time for me to do something for me. I have things in my life that I want to do that don't revolve around December 25th. Mm-hmm. And look, mm-hmm. I love you, Chris.
I love you too,
Chris. That's nice. That's nice.
Thank you. Yeah. I do, and I'm proud of the joy that you bring to millions.
It's billions. But it's billions, actually.
Billions.
Might be trillions at this point.
Okay.
I'm just saying.
Leave it. It's just, who am I without being Mrs. Claus? Does that make sense?
Oh, yes. I see you.
Thank you.
I really do. Santa, how does it make you feel to hear your wife say those words?
Not great.
Okay. Okay. Why not?
She doesn't want to be my wife anymore.
That's absolutely not true. I feel like you want me to have one identity.
Carol, I want you to have whatever identity you want to have. I just don't want to be embarrassed.
Oh, embarrassed?
Yep.
Okay.
Is this about the Zumba?
Yes.
Sorry, what's Zumba?
Oh my gosh, you don't know what Zumba
no.
is?
No, that's because you don't need to know
yes,
about
it. Yes, you do need to know. Yes, it is a Latin dance-inspired workout.
Yes, it's that's what I thought.
So fun. It's very effective. My friend Martha and
okay,
I.
Okay, they just do it so that they can drink wine after they work out.
Okay.
That seems
so
to be the
nice.
Point.
We don't do it so we can drink wine. That's a fun part of it, and we like that. But that's not the only reason we do. Like, I want 1 hour a day where I can feel sexy.
And I just don't want it in my house. She wants to build a Zumba studio in our basement.
And Chris said no.
Ooh, have you tried asking for it for Christmas?
Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye. Whoso pulleth this sword Excalibur whence from this stone shall be set forth heretofore as the true heir, and will be crowned the once and future King of England. Young Arthur, step forward, test thy fate.
Ah! I am the true heir. Ha! It, yay, right? Right, guys? What?
Did you fart?
No.
Sorry, but yes, you did when you pulled the sword from the stone. I heard you fart. You farted.
That wasn't me.
I heard it too, and we can smell it.
Okay, I didn't fart.
Yes, you did. You farted.
No, I didn't. And you can't talk to me like that because I'm the true heir to the throne. No fart.
Then why does it smell like fart?
I don't know, because you guys all farted.
Okay. Listen, I don't know.
What?
We're going to have to check to see if you can still even be king, because that's...
Well, no, you don't, because I am king.
Well, yes. I'm just saying we're going to have to check. I don't...
Check what?
The procedural bylaws.
You don't even know. Okay. You're saying that there is a specific rule that says that the true heir to the throne... If he farts when he pulls the sword from the stone, now he's not the king.
Maybe. Now, laws have been written.
Do you know what? Actually, just give me the sword, because this is highly
unusual. No,
Arthur,
please don't take it.
Give me the sword now. Give me the sword.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for listening to Unvoiced, starring Alex Coggin, Mary Holland, and Catherine Mangold. Unvoiced was written and created in a 6-day residency with Parallel 45 Theater Company by these three artists under the direction of me and Michael Norton. Thanks for the audio support by Jordan Anderson, production support by Aaron Whiting, Stacia Sexton, and Kit McKay. Unvoiced was produced by Parallel 45 Theater Company in Traverse City, Michigan. For more information, go to parallel45.org.
So I am Michael Norton. I work in all kinds of things in the arts. And I have the pleasure to be in a call with three of my favorite people in the world, who we made a thing together, with whom we all made a thing together. Like, how long ago was that?
Two summers or three summers ago?
Yeah,
a while ago. First is Catherine Mangold, who is an actor based in Los Angeles now. She's in her lovely apartment there. And Mary Holland, who is also an actor, also in Los Angeles, who's got her world map behind her. And Alex Coggin, who is a photographer and artist based in London, and he has his candles. how are you guys doing?
Medium. I'd say medium. Solid 5 out of 10.
Obviously, this so much has happened and changed since we originally made this. We've all moved around. Catherine and Alex and I lived together for a little while. And Catherine then subsequently moved to Los Angeles. So I'm really kind of interested in revisiting this moment where we kind of, it almost feels like basically got a summer holiday in Michigan together and then made something that hasn't really been revisited. I mean, I don't know if you guys have listened ever, but I feel like we kind of left that summer and this thing kind of just sat. Yeah, I guess I'll say kind of the premise of what it was, and then I think it'd be really great if you guys wanted to like kind of fill in what we actually did. So the call was that from Kit was to make, it was during a development season for P45, and they wanted to do something in the summer that could tour easily to like donors' homes, basically, or to homes for fundraising opportunities. And it was kind of a carte blanche ask, and I had this idea. I think that maybe Alex, we had been talking about it, about like how funny it would be to hear from like the mice and Cinderella, like to hear from all of these like kind of the fully fleshed out characters. What do you say?
Peripheral characters.
Yeah, to take the peripheral characters and kind of fully flesh them out.
I remember one of the things that we started with as an idea but didn't end up latching onto was imagine the spear carrier in Hamlet.
Yeah.
So what is that? What does that feel like? What's that character's experience?
Yeah, yeah. And obviously there was a lot of funny ha-ha potential in that. So much.
I think Mary and I both agree.
Oh yeah, we're on the same page about that.
So, we're talking about the chart you made now. Or later?
I don't really remember.
Sorry, was it? Yeah, there's a little haha chart.
Yeah. The secret of comedy.
Oh, yeah.
When you explained to us what comedy was. And
yes.
Stick figures and
yes, you threw an audience and was like, okay, and then we come out and then they're like, ha ha ha. And then
they hear ha ha, they come back and everyone knows it's ha ha. We all are ha ha together.
We all ha ha together. And that is comedy.
It, I mean, tell me it's not.
Prove it.
So I asked all of you if you would come and hang out in Traverse City for what, it was like 2 weeks, I think. And we made this in, I think it was like 6 or 7 days in that studio by the train tracks. And the way that we made it, but the way that I imagined making it, we can talk about what actually happened. The way that I kind of imagined making it was like treating it a bit like a writer's room, so that the primary role of us was not necessarily to like rehearse and perfect something, but it was actually to kind of like spitball and to throw ideas around and to make something that was almost as strong in hearing or in reading than it would be as a piece of theater. I think that none of us, when we were working on it, actually imagined this thing being a full stageable production. It wouldn't really make sense.
We weren't making a sketch for what it was going to become, or like a first draft of what we wanted. We didn't want to turn this into a full length. We wanted it to be the thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and I made sure that all of you, I don't know if this was actually structured, I don't know if you guys remember, but you all three talked into microphones the entire time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For like 8 hours a day.
Out of nowhere. It just felt,
yeah.
It really like turned us, I think it elevated like our just regular banter into, now this is, I'm contributing now,
yeah.
Which was felt more concrete.
Love that. And also I felt it was a interesting, I also was really not, I mean like you three are such incredibly spontaneous and talented people that like, I feel like I was just trying to set it as a director, or I would say that for this, I felt even more just like a facilitator, that like, I just wanted to set up things so like you could just, I, like I would, nothing was in your way. So like the format that I'd imagined was like small provocations, and then you guys would go away and do all the work, and I would just like sit there, and then you would all come back, and we would like pass scripts and stuff around, or pass ideas around. I don't know if you guys remember like that kind of Genesis phase, but were there some, do you remember some of the, first off, how some of the ideas that we came up with like were born?
I remember us discussing how to best communicate this idea of characters that are familiar to everybody, but who nobody has heard from or has heard speak. And so that meant brainstorming like super universal stories that everybody knows, like fairy tales.
I think we had some
crossover ideas of like borderline biblical stuff, I thought too. We were like,
like a common mythology that right. is universally known. And I remember that being like where our conversation revolved around initially, was in thinking about those very common stories and the characters that we know about but don't ever hear from.
Yeah. And how did you guys, so it was like, I think that you kind of chose, you would choose a character or choose a premise and then go off and write. And I'm wondering if you have any memories of like what were some of the ways that you crossed these stories, or what were some of the ways that you kind of like messed with the ways that we think about some of the people we came up with? Yeah, Catherine?
I liked, there would be, as I recall, there was like a real spitballing session, brainstorming session. You would write down all of the ideas, and then we divvied up. If there was something that was really speaking to you, then you called it and went to work on it. But I liked that because you ended up not working necessarily on your own idea. Like that managed to make it, like nobody gets hurt feelings if something gets cut, because it's all, we're all doing it together. You know, it's not like you squirrel away and present something hoping that, you know, everyone else will think it's funny. It's like, no, we're all trying to make it work together, make it function together. So that, I was always really grateful for that. It was like a communal ownership.
Yes, a real collaboration.
Yeah.
I do hear that.
It's okay, Alex.
The physical, like what you were talking about, Catherine, the actual physical, like, I feel like Michael did such a cool thing that I haven't really experienced in a writing environment.
Thank you.
which was the physical visual element of it, I feel like he really leaned into, and so all the ideas that were talked about were put on paper and then were printed on separate pieces of paper. And so like got laid out on the floor in front of us. And then it was almost like the ideas then didn't, to Catherine's point about it being nothing felt super individual. It felt like a whole group thing, was that the ideas were sort of out there and not just staying in our heads or as a concept. It was like we got them out, and then they were physically out there, and then we could take them and work on them, and that for like group ownership.
There was also, and we all looked like absolute madmen because there was just so many papers taped up everywhere. You know, it would look like an insanity.
Yeah. It also felt nice to be like, well, this is as far as I got with this one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In a way, you
and someone who was
facilitated an environment where we couldn't fail. So
yeah,
I was a write for you guys, you know, knowing, ooh, this is something that Alex did that I am inspired by, but I'm writing with him in mind. Yeah. And that was really fun.
Yeah. I was also thinking, I think I remember, and having conversations with people, because the three of you are such like gifted improvisers. And I thought like, oh, we'll just do a lot of like on your feet, like improvising. But I don't think we did any of that, did we? Really? It was mostly
Mostly it was writing, right? It was private, felt.
Yeah.
I think we did. We did some improv a couple of times to get us out of a sticky spot. But as I recall, it didn't. It was just to unlock some things, and we didn't actually use any of that material. It was just like, I don't know what's happening here. Can we just improv about it a little bit, and then just to like answer some questions?
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. So we're gonna listen to this in a minute, and then we'll talk more about like memories of. I'm interested to remember. It's like, I loved talking to people about the things that we cut and why. So if you remember anything,
yes,
let's.
May forever rest in peace, Alex's Footman Twitter monologue, yeah, which I will remember for the rest of my life.
Yes.
What was it? Play of the Valkyries playing behind you.
Oh my God.
That was one of the last things we cut. We just said it wasn't working, right?
Yeah.
So, tragedy, as far as I'm concerned.
I was happy to be done with it. I was like, this is too much.
We even like printed it on placards, didn't we? It was like,
yes.
Yes, we did.
Actual capital in that that sketch.
Yeah, and the computer noises out.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was avant-garde, you know.
Before its time.
Yeah.
So we'll have after to talk about other things that maybe we cut and missed. But we're gonna listen to this. So this is the first time we've listened to it in like 3 years. Was it 3 years ago? Is that right?
I think it was like 4 or 5. I thought it was 2015.
Was it before after Donald Trump was elected? That's my like
post Trump.
It was post Trump.
It was definitely post Trump. Yeah, I think it was the summer before last. We should be able to do it.
Calendars or emails. Let me check my text messages.
So, Catherine, was it when we were living together? Must have been, if it was.
Yes, it was. It was. Yes, it was.
Can so confirm. Probably like 2017-ish. Anyways, it's been a while since we listened to this. And I just want to get... just briefly from each of you, what are you expecting, if anything, from listening to this?
I don't know.
I don't know.
I feel like I'm definitely gonna be like, oh God.
Yeah.
Well, it's tough watching or listening to anything that you do.
Anyway,
you know,
I just can't imagine that this is going to be anybody's most nuanced work,
right? My expectation is like, ooh, this is going to be like watching a high school play that you thought you were great in, and like you go back and watch it, and you're like,
I'd say maybe,
but we weren't looking to necessarily be making a nuanced piece, it was meant as a like showcase of some ideas and some people who we work with and some character and personality and in a cocktail setting that is fun and a little thought provoking and you know, not just, we didn't unfortunately do any tap dances or anything, you know, it's so it was an exercise to give a glimmer of what P45 is interested in, but still be fun for drinks.
Right. And one thing too that I think to bear in mind as we listen is that the we really put a lot of thought into the choreography of this show. Like, we had these little podiums, but we would bring chairs out in front, or like it was a dance. It really was choreographed so that while it was casual, it was still a show. It was sort of, you know, cabaret-y. Yeah.
Very deliberate. When you're sitting and standing and on stage, off stage, well, always being on stage, was, we didn't want it to look sloppy. We wanted it to look slick, but casual, like you said.
And you're both, the three of you, like, you're both talented writers, but you're also like,
Which two?
I said the three of you are both talented. Let me finish my sentence.
Let him finish, Alex.
I just want to say. I'm sorry. I just want to say you two are my favorite people in the world. Okay, love you guys.
Okay, you. So the three of you are both talented writers, but also gifted physical comedians. So the. What you're missing from this, I love that we're like already apologizing for this thing before it started. What you're missing from this is that it's not meant to be recorded as an audio piece and it's complete, like, that's not how it's meant to be received. We did record it, I think it was like the day before you left, Mary, because you had to leave a day early. It was the day, like, right as before you were leaving, and we like went to
that barn house was so good.
Yeah.
That one had the good snacks.
We went to a studio in Traverse. Would you guys remember the radio station there?
Yes, right on Front Street there.
Crystal.
Yeah.
And we recorded this, like, and then kind of they threw in some audio effects afterwards. I don't know if you guys ever listened to it, but there's like quite a lot of effects and stuff kind of thrown in, like, yeah. Anyways.
Wait, I'm so scared.
I'm nervous.
Okay. Here we go.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome aboard your unvoiced character journey. Please note that the writer has turned on the inconsequential sign. If you haven't done so, please stow your emotional baggage underneath the seat in front of you, or in the overhead bins provided, or so deep inside of you that your eyes remain blank. We remind you that, for you, this is a non-dialogue flight. Tampering with, adding to, or fleshing out the script is, of course, prohibited. Please refrain from upstaging the main characters in any way. If you are seated in an emergency exit row, please leave that seat immediately. That's far too much action for you to be involved in. Your crew will be coming by with your thinly developed backstory shortly after takeoff. We know you have a choice when you travel, and we thank you for your commitment to maintaining your one-dimensional selves.
Wow.
Okay.
So good.
Does that land now?
Does it land?
Oh.
I thought it was funny.
I tried to come into this as sort of thinking about like a person that might have been there. Like, what are we talking about?
Yeah.
Well, I think it goes with context. Maybe we keep playing it because, you know, it's all about the context, right?
Yeah.
What are we talking about?
Keep playing it.
Okay, all right, we're going to carry right on.
Okay.
I think it's...
Okay, case 89435, please step forward.
Yes, Your Honor.
Please state your name for the record.
Tooth Fairy.
Okay, Miss Tooth.
Sorry, so it's not first name Tooth, last name Fairy.
That's what I have here in my records.
Yes, that's incorrect. It's just one name, Tooth Fairy. It's like Madonna, but two words.
Okay, so Ms. Tooth Fairy.
That's right, okay. Yes.
All right, and you are here today to contest a parking citation, is that correct?
Yes.
All right, you have a parking ticket on Kushner Street where you parked for more than the allowed 10 minutes in a loading zone.
Right. Your Honor, if I may.
Yeah.
This is so unfair. Ever since the city privatized street parking, I've run into these issues. You see, there was a seven-year-old on the sixth floor of a...
I just want to say that was very topical because they were privatizing street parking in Traverse City, if you remember.
Oh, I was like, what was the joke there?
A high-rise apartment building, he lost his tooth, so I had to go up there and had to get
First of all, please, why are you driving when you have wings?
Sir, look at me. I'm the size of a fingernail. I mean, you think I can just fly when I have to lug a quarter that is, forgive me, the size of my body up six flights of stairs? My back is killing me, and my health insurance won't cover it. They say it's a pre-existing condition because I guess I've been around for eternity or whatever.
It says here that you were parked there for over 2 hours. Care to explain? Ms. Tooth Fairy.
I don't think I should have to answer that.
What were you doing for those 2 hours, ma'am?
Hey, you can't ask me that. That's my own private business as a private citizen.
Okay, it's very simple. You broke the rules, you pay.
I can't afford to pay. I can't afford to pay this. I have no money. No money. I have teeth. I have stacks and stacks of human teeth. I lose money. I mean, I give people money for their teeth. So, okay, here's the thing. I got some bad advice, right? We all have. I have a cousin named Donnie, and he assured me that teeth would be trading at the same rate as gold on the commodities market by now. But then, of course, the ivory trade ruined it for everybody.
Look,
and you know, excuse me. You know what else? Do you know what else? In Norway?
In Norway.
Yeah, in Norway, I know fairies who get 6 weeks off a year. Okay, I am not one of those work one day a year holiday icons. I mean, I am on call 24 hours a day.
Okay,
I feel
Mr.
like I'm
Fair, please,
losing
please
my
down.
Mind.
Please pull yourself together.
Okay.
I don't see how any of this sob story is relevant to the fact that you broke the law.
Can I pay for this ticket in teeth?
Sure.
Okay.
Nice.
It lands. Well, I think that the thing that I forgot about this is that like we were truly like Trojan horsing some like mega liberal agenda to these parties.
Yeah, like they're not even gonna realize like.
That was like about privatization and like welfare state.
Right, we let's clip in those things. That's right. That's right. That's right. We told them, didn't we?
We told them. Oh my gosh. They
universal
for sure.
Health care.
But like, what are we talking about? No, I think that I feel like that's kind of a fun example of like it's almost like taking what I thought we did in this show was like take these like fictional characters or stories and like play out what is a real world situation that you would find them in and hear them deal with that.
We did lists. We had our lists of characters, like 30 characters, and lists of real life mundane situations, and just spider cross lined them together to be like, oh, it'd be real funny if the Tooth Fairy got a parking citation, or you know, like, or let's put the seven dwarves in this situation.
Yeah.
And that I feel like once we figured out that format, it really liberated us, you know?
Do you chronically look for adventure? Do you have a relentless urge to travel to a fantasy land, losing the respect of your loved ones because you're continually fleeing reality, always looking for your happily ever after? At last, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. Ask your doctor about AdventureSil and find out if it could be right for you. Start living your most grounded life. today.
Okay. All right. Welcome, everyone, to Partners of Adults Who Had Life-Changing Adventures as Children. I'm Jeff, husband to Wendy Darling.
Hi,
Jeff. You are loved and you are interesting. All right,
thanks. Ted, do you want to?
Sure, yeah. I am Ted. Thanks for having me. I am married to Dorothy.
Hi, Ted. You are loved and you are interesting.
Thanks.
And I see some new faces here
hi.
This week.
Yeah, hi. Thanks. I'm Martha. I'm married to Alice. So, you know, Wonderland.
Oof. Yikes.
Yeah. Hi, Martha. You are loved and you are interesting.
All right. Thank you guys and girls for coming. Let's get started. Does anybody have anything this week they'd like to share?
God, yes, yeah, please. Yeah.
Ted, go ahead.
Yeah. So Dorothy has really crossed the line.
Sorry. Just start talking.
I love the premise, really. I love it. I'm so curious if we're going to deliver.
I feel like we...
Hey, premise!
I feel like this one, we really batted around a lot.
Yeah.
Like, I think that
we... There are three big characters. It was dense. Yeah. It's like, how do we clean this up and make it easy to understand?
And what were like the characters who had gone on the most like kind of wild adventures whose partner, like what would be the nice partner combination? And then like I think all of you were swapping roles a lot. So I think that, yeah, Alex, I don't know if it lands. Let's see. We're just testing out to see if our content was already made works. This is great.
Years ago.
I mean, she's always gone on and on about Oz, and that's fine. I mean, I don't love it, but it's fine. Okay, so we put in a new driveway. Last week, I go to work, I come home, come to find out she's painted it. Guess what color?
No,
please, guess what color?
Yellow.
That's right, yellow.
Oh.
We now have a goddamn yellow driveway. It's the eyesore of the neighborhood. Anyway, that's it.
Oh, you are loved and you are interesting.
Thanks for sharing, Ted. Thanks a lot. That's real tough stuff.
Yeah. Can I go next?
Yes, of course.
Thanks. I'm so glad I found you guys. I didn't know where else to turn because Alice, she went down the rabbit hole when she was just this little girl, you know, and in many ways, I don't think that she ever really fully came back. Mm. And it used to be just this dreamy, like distant thing in her eyes. Like, okay, so we'd be on the sofa of a Tuesday watching The Voice, and then bam, she's down the rabbit hole. I could see the swirls in her pupils. And that was, you know, that was one thing, but now it has developed. It's much more like sleepwalking. She kidnapped the boy from next door's pet rabbit, kept asking it for the time. We're stuck in traffic, and she spies a manhole across the road. She jumps out of the car. She crosses lanes of traffic, wrenches open the manhole, dives down into it, into the sewer. It's disgusting.
It's gross.
It's disgusting. She, who? She invited a homeless gentleman into our house, gave him all of my hats to wear, and I found them having a tea party with my Christmas china.
Oh, wow.
I didn't know this man. I didn't feel safe in my own home. So, yes. Yes, I have been crushing an adventure sill and putting it into her smoothie in the morning just so that I can have a peaceful day.
Hi, I'm Wendy Moira Angela Darling, and I started taking Adventure Cell when I had just about enough of Neverland, thank you. I was more than ready to grow up. One pill, twice daily, and my life has completely turned around. I run a company and wear pantsuits, my dry cleaner knows me, and I haven't been on a pirate ship or spoken to a mermaid in years. With Adventure Cell, I can do the things in my life that I need to get done.
Adventure Cell is not necessarily for everyone. Side effects include feelings of complacency, rejection of imaginary characters, depression, anal leakage, and lack of whimsy.
Adventure Cell, grow up.
We slipped that liberal agenda in there again.
Yeah. you mean because of the anal leakage?
Yeah.
Yeah, too many poppers.
Oh my God. That is very, it's very funny. I think it's holding up.
I think it's holding up. I think it's holding up better. I think we're doing.
I was worried that it was going to be too, just too premise-y, you know? Yeah. But actually, I think it's cute. I think it's cute.
Casting, real liberal of us too, you know? We don't care. We don't see gender.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. I also love Catherine, and she gave him all of my hats.
So a couple of years ago, I was at a bar with some girlfriends, and we were sitting there and we were having a drink, and I sort of felt like someone was looking at me, how you can kind of sense it. And I turned around and I made eye contact with this boy, a kid, a teenager, and he was looking at me very intensely. He smiled and I smiled back. I was being polite, and he made a beeline for me. We started talking, and so quick note about me, I avoid confrontation at all costs. I can't difficult conversations with people about things that make me uncomfortable or behavior that makes me uncomfortable. I'm just like, hey, let's don't worry about it. Let's not do it. So I don't have those confrontations generally. And so this kid is talking to me. We're talking, and he, you know, finds out my name, and he's saying, "Rosaline, you're so beautiful. You're the most beautiful woman I've ever seen." And you know, I'm like, oh, that's nice. But I do try to make it clear to him that I'm not interested romantically, obviously. And that's that. And then things started to get a little weird. I started seeing him everywhere. I would run into him at the grocery store or at the coffee shop where I worked. On my morning run, he just kind of popped up everywhere. And I still never said anything to him about it. Never had a confrontation. Never.
Alex?
I genuinely forget where this is going.
Oh, really? Oh, no.
Like, genuinely do not remember.
Right.
All right.
That's all.
Great. So you're the audience. Here you go.
Yeah, disgusted with him. Yeah. And one night, I woke up and I looked out my bedroom window, and he was standing underneath my balcony. And I was like, yikes, well, he's underneath my balcony. How did he find out where I lived? And I don't know. I mean, but you know, kids and computers and Google, whatever. Anyway, the point is I saw him there. And while I was a little worried, I think I mostly wrote it off as a kid with a crush. It seemed harmless. He just seemed, I've been lovesick before. I can empathize with where he was coming from. So I never said anything to him about it. He showed up under my balcony every night that week, calling my name, "Rosaline, Rosaline, I love you. I love you. You're so beautiful." And I just sort of didn't do anything about it. And then it stopped. He stopped. He was gone. I didn't see him anymore. He was no longer at the grocery store, no longer at the coffee shop. I don't know what happened, but I was relieved. And life went on as usual. And then one day I came into my work at the coffee shop, and there was a woman there, a customer. She was reading the newspaper. She called me over and she said, "Did you hear about this?" And I said, "Hear about what?" And she said, "A couple of teenagers just did this suicide pact thing." And I said, "Oh God, that's terrible." And then she read their names, and she read his name,
I get it.
Romeo. And I started replaying in my head all of the behavior that I wrote off as just a kid with a crush. I started replaying it all in my head, and I started seeing it as not just a kid with a crush. I saw it for the obsessiveness that it was showing. Like, I started thinking about how he acted and how it wasn't harmless, and how I knew that in some way. Like, I knew there was something dangerous about the intensity with which he pursued his love or his feelings for me. And I never said anything to him about it. I never had that confrontation with him. And I feel like we need to have those conversations with our sons and our brothers and our friends, the men in our lives, and tell them, show them what love looks like. Love is not possession, and it's not obsession, and it's not showing up under people's balconies and calling to them in the middle of the night. It's love is kindness, and it's respect, and it's listening. And I feel like I'm complicit in some way in what happened with Romeo and Juliet. If I had had that confrontation, that difficult conversation with Romeo, then I feel like he and Juliet might still be alive today.
Remember, we discussed so much how we didn't, like, how to walk the line between, like, lecturing people about it and just also just being honest and
Well, I remember,
you know, we didn't want to tell people that the men in this audience are bad. Yeah.
Was this pre-Harvey Weinstein?
Yeah, but it was pre-Harvey Weinstein, but it was right in the middle of Me Too. So it still felt...
In the middle?
If it was 2 years ago, it was like...
Yeah, I think that we did this the summer of 17, which, like, the Women's March and everything kicked off, because you guys went to D.C.
Yeah.
In January of 2017, I think, right?
Yeah.
So, like, this is pre, like, Blasey Ford, Kavanaugh.
Oh, fascinating.
We were, I think as a country, we were still, like, getting used to this kind of terminology, this way of talking about it, saying, like, I am complicit in this. I am, you know, that we need to teach people how to love. Like, this, now it's funny to listen to that because I feel like people are so much more fluent in that language. If we wrote it today, we could have a lighter touch with it.
Yeah.
Because we know how to get there really quick because we've been talking about it for years. Mm-hmm. Like, this wasn't a flash in the pan idea of what love should look like and mm-hmm. what is appropriate and what is...
Mm-hmm. Right.
I remember our first question was... Sorry, Mary, go ahead.
No.
I remember wasn't our first thing like, are people going to know who Rosalind is? Are people going to, you know, what? Because it was also outside of the fairy tale character, too.
Yeah.
But I love how idiosyncratic we just let Mary.
Yeah. And that it doesn't matter, like, it doesn't matter if they don't know until the very end. In fact, I think that was the idea, that suddenly you're listening to a moth story.
That's what I was gonna say, was that the part of our goal with, I remember how we were going to present each of these ideas and premises, was we were gonna change the mode of presentation. So like a commercial or a group therapy session or a, like that, it was sort of built into the premise in a lot of cases. But I think this was like a mode of telling us of, yeah, the moth format, which if you listen to moth stories, they're like stories from people's lives, but at the end they have some sort of like moral or wisdom that they learned from this story. So it was kind of really being modeled after that format.
It takes it from anecdote to purposeful.
It feels like we were really coming up close to rape culture and sexual assault culture without.
Yeah.
I remember, because I remember playing, like thinking about structure and like feeling like it was so important to include things that weren't just like kind of jokes.
Yeah.
And I remember the first night, because we sandwiched this right in the middle of like some real haha. And I remember the first night, like just that sense of like, are people with us? We're kind of reading the audience. Or was this the like go and refill your drink moment? And like every night we had people by then, and this really held them. And again, that thing, I'm actually being reminded now as we listen to it more that like there was something deeply political about what we were trying to do. Actually, it wasn't just like funny. It was like that there are stories of people who are considered to be like B characters for whatever reason, or C characters for whatever reason, and we can give them an update, and that like a lot of these fairy tales are like really not appropriate for children now. Like there was a lot of violence in them, a lot of misogyny in them, a lot of heteronormativity that was like quite violent for myself as a queer person learning about these stories. So like this reminded me that like we did have an agenda. You know, we did want to challenge ourselves and our audiences to like both use humor as a way of having a nice time, but also using that humor to like kind of subvert these stories a bit.
To give a platform to, so that if the idea is to give a platform to people who have never been heard from again, how do we look at that in our own life? When we look around and look at all the people in the world who don't have a voice, who don't have a platform. So it becomes a metaphor, obviously, the greater
political. Were you looking at making eye contact with people during that, do you remember?
Yeah, I think I was. I think I really was treating it like I was telling the story at the moment.
Yeah, you took your mic and like walked in front of the mics, the music stands, and were like kind of mothing. I mean,
I was mothing so hard, dude. Yeah, I also think that it's just from a messaging standpoint, like. You gotta get them with the ha-has, and then you hit them with the message.
Yeah, pull the rug out from under them. You want people to be right. Gasping for
look,
it.
It's theater 101. It's like theater 101.
You gotta get them with the ha-has, though.
But it was just like a peek at it. It wasn't, we didn't rake anybody over any coals. It was just like, hey, we're thinking about this right now. Okay, more ha-ha.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and even though we're talking about each of these, the whole thing was so quick. I mean, I think it was like, it was under 30 minutes. It was like 25 minutes. So it really packed a punch.
I don't remember us ever, like I could be wrong about this, but I feel like these political elements of the show, I don't remember ever being deliberate. Like, no. it was, I mean, we're, the four of us, I think, are of the same, political persuasion, so it just kind of happened. But that's also, I think, when, to Catherine's point, like, when you are discussing this idea of unvoiced or people who don't have platforms or we don't hear from, you're the inherently there's going to be a political element to that because it is so true to what's actually happening in the world in so many ways. So like, I don't remember it being like, well, we need to hit this message of, you know, how men view love or anything. It was just like, well, no, if we're doing a dive into like characters who don't have a voice or, then it just naturally.
We need to talk about real things as well.
Yeah.
So without it feeling like we're gonna give a speech about how we feel about the world. It's just, no, these are the things that matter. So more haha?
So more ha. All right.
Let's ha-ha.
I mean, hopefully, like, honestly, hopefully.
Bring it up.
That is hopefully, we are just dramaturgically mapping the experience that we were trying to create for.
Let's go with that. Let's go with that. I like that. Let's go with that.
Like this contemplative dark moment where you're like, just doing a little bit of reflection on where you are and the power that you hold. And then, haha.
Alrighty, woohoo, y'all. You all know how speed dating works. When you hear the bell, you move on to the next table and you be your most charming selves. Good luck out there. On your marks, get set, date.
Hi. So, Big Bad Wolf here. A couple of facts about me. I'm a foodie, is what I am. I love taking long walks through the wood, although I haven't been able to really do much of that lately because I've been sort of recovering from a like an involuntary surgery. It's a really funny story. I ate a grandma.
Oh, well, hello there. You look beautiful. Me, I'm Pinocchio, Italian. And a couple things about me. Well, I am a real boy, but I don't have a birth mother. What? I'm a bit of a gambler, but it's not a problem. My best friends are animals, and well, as far as the bedroom is concerned, let's just say I have a lot to offer. Sorry. Ow! Ow! My nose!
We're the three little pigs.
Joey.
Zoe.
Dwayne.
We don't know how to be alone.
So we go on our dates together.
And if this goes well, you'll have three spouses. One for talking.
One for cleaning.
And one for fun.
For fuck.
Mr. Claus. Mrs.
Should we just carry on?
Yeah.
Mrs. Claus. I'm so glad to have both of you here. Couples therapy can be very challenging and even a little scary.
And expensive.
Okay, thank you. And, but, you know, it's important to know that it can help harbor intimacy and help build new stories.
Mm-hmm.
I should say before we start that I am such a big fan of the work that both of you do for children.
Oh, both of us do. That's a laugh.
Jesus. Carol.
What?
Okay.
What?
Okay, hey.
Can you keep it a little...
Hey, listen. Let's slow down. Let's start again. Why do you think you guys are here?
Well, go ahead.
Please?
No.
Go.
Okay. I guess I'll go first. We're here because Carol wanted to stop crying all the time.
Wow, Chris.
Well,
wow. Is that what you think it is?
Literally, that's what you said, that you were constantly crying.
I didn't say that I was crying all of the time. I said that I was experiencing a sadness.
Okay, right. And, so anyway, can you fix her?
Oh, okay. Hey, let's focus on just listening to each other. Let's start again. Carol?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus? Why do you think you're here?
Okay, so when Chris and I first got together, I was so young, and I felt like it was my duty to be supportive of him. You know, that's what wives did at that time. So I did all of the wish list receiving, constantly updating his naughty and nice lists. I did all the hiring and the firing of the elves, just everything.
I'm sorry, did you not like building your dream house at the North Pole?
It has nothing to do with that, Chris.
You seem to have enjoyed that.
Yeah.
Chris, you will get your turn to speak, I promise, but it's Carol's turn right now.
Thank you.
Carol, please, you're doing great.
Thanks. Okay, anyway, and now I feel like it's just time for me to do something for me. I have things in my life that I want to do that don't revolve around December 25th. Mm-hmm. And look, mm-hmm. I love you, Chris.
I love you too.
That's nice. That's nice.
Thank you. Yeah. I do. And I'm proud of the joy that you bring to millions.
Billions. But it's billions, actually.
Billions.
Might be trillions at this point.
Okay. Okay.
I'm just saying.
Leave it. It's just, who am I without being Mrs. Claus? Does that make sense?
Oh, yes. I see you.
Thank you.
I really do. Santa, how does it make you feel to hear your wife say those words?
Not great.
Okay. Okay. Why not?
She doesn't want to be my wife anymore.
That's absolutely not true. I feel like you want me to have one identity.
Carol, I want you to have whatever identity you want to have. I just don't want to be embarrassed.
Oh, embarrassed?
Yep.
Okay. Is this about the Zumba?
Yes.
Sorry, what's Zumba?
Oh my gosh, you don't know what Zumba is?
No, that's because you don't need to know
Yes,
about
you do
it.
Need to know. Yes, it is a Latin dance-inspired workout.
Yes,
it's
that's what I thought.
So fun. It's very effective. My friend Martha and
okay,
I,
okay, they just
we
do
get
it so that they can drink wine after they work out.
Okay.
That seems
so
to be the
nice.
Point.
We don't do it so we can drink wine. That's a fun part of it, and we like that. But that's not the only reason we do it. Like, I want 1 hour a day where I can feel sexy.
And I just don't want it in my house. She wants to build a Zumba studio in our basement.
And Chris said no.
Ooh, have you tried asking for it for Christmas?
Now, I'm going to tell you something about that. That scene, first off, every night got about a minute and a half longer. Which I loved. Your pauses were always longer, and like the back chatter. I think that we actually, I think I remember having a conversation with you guys. I was like, guys, I love you. For the radio recording, we need to tighten this one up.
And I think we could have still tightened it. Like, I think we could have done that. I think we could have done that in, you know, 2/3 of the time. You know, totally. Easy.
But it killed in the audience.
Well, I think we're talking about like second wave feminist, like almost like a failed second wave feminist.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Plus heteronormativity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Check.
Plus wine. I mean, the wine.
Okay, in a weird way, I thought this sketch made the donors like the most uncomfortable kind of.
Yeah. Yeah.
Really? Don't you feel like it was like a little uncomfortable?
But like, some nods of recognition, like, oh yeah, we've been to couples therapy.
Oh yeah, that, yes.
Yeah, that like, oh, sure. I know this, we've tried this.
Uh-huh.
I think that's why we gave it permission to just be as long as we wanted, because it was very relatable content.
Yeah. Okay, last one. I think it's last
hear
one.
Ye, hear Wait. Ye, hear ye. Whoso pulleth this sword Excalibur, whence from this stone shall be set forth heretofore as the true heir, and will be crowned the once and future King of England. Young Arthur, step forward, test thy fate.
I am the true heir.
Do you hear one more time?
No, wait a minute, because for those, there might be people that are watching this with no context of the thing. And so it's, so I think I'll go ahead and explain.
Okay.
It is the sword and the stone. What isn't it? The sword and the stone?
Yes, obviously. Yeah. It's like Arthur, the true heir, must pull the sword from, like Catherine said.
Okay, but people need to know that he's pulling out the sword. And then go back and play the special part.
From this stone shall be set forth heretofore as the true heir, and will be crowned the once and future King of England. Young Arthur, step forward, test thy fate.
Ah! I am the true heir. Ha! It, yay, right? Right, guys?
What? Did you fart?
No.
Sorry, but you did when you pulled the sword from the stone. No, I heard you fart. You farted.
That wasn't me.
I heard it too, and we can smell it.
Okay, I didn't fart.
Yes, okay? You did. You farted.
No, I didn't. And you can't talk to me like that because I'm the true heir to the throne. No fart.
Then why does it smell like fart?
I don't know, because you guys all farted.
Okay. Listen, I don't know.
What?
We're gonna have to check to see if you can still even be king, because that's...
Well, no, you don't, because I am king.
Well, yes. I'm just saying we're going to have to check. I don't...
Check what?
The procedural bylaws.
You don't even know. You're saying that there is a specific rule that says that the true heir to the throne, if he farts when he pulls the sword from the stone, now he's not the king.
Maybe.
Laws have been written.
Do you know what? Actually, just give me the sword, because this is highly
unusual. No,
Arthur,
please don't take it.
Give me the sword now. Give me the sword.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for listening to Unvoiced, starring Alex.
Oh, I made that audio. It's
Alex Coggin, Mary Holland, and Catherine Mangold. Unvoiced was written and created in a 6-day residency with Parallel 45 Theater Company by these three artists under the direction of me and Michael Norton. Thanks for the audio support by Jordan Anderson, production support by Aaron Whiting, Stacia Sexton, and Kit McKay. Unvoiced was produced by Parallel 45 Theater Company and...
Okay.
Had to end with a fart joke.
Got it.
We were insistent upon that.
Completely forgot about...
That's a butt.
It's a butt.
I'm trying to turn it off.
That also killed the fart.
Yeah.
I mean.
Did it? I don't remember that.
I remember it killing, and I remember being like, this is going to be really tough to, like, change into an audio experience, this particular sketch.
It worked.
And it should have been so much quicker, so much quicker.
When we came up with and connect the dots of the Arthur, the fart, we laughed for how long?
Oh.
We laughed for like half a day. We thought that was the funniest, most juvenile, fucking.
let's go from couples therapy to fart right now.
Also the defense, Arthur's defense is like, very, very clearly ripped and influenced and borderline ripped from Trump tweet language.
Yeah.
I remember the
I'm not, king
puppet, the not, not a puppet, you're the puppet kind of talk.
Yeah.
And, yeah, wow.
I'm looking back through our Google Doc of our, like, I guess it's like our halfway through, Doc, and I just want to list a couple things off that we had thought about, but we discarded, so I will go through them now.
Oh, no.
There was one with four different people doing a Instagram video, like self-care videos, and they were Rapunzel.
Medusa?
Lady Macbeth, yeah. Medusa, and that's it, just the three of them.
I think that if we were doing... like some of these things, I remember being like, oh, if we were doing video, these things, like some of these felt more kind of like TV sketchy.
Uh-huh.
Okay, another one that was great was Cinderella wanted to do some open mic night poetry.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I was sad to lose that Cinderella slam poetry.
Yes. Ash to ash.
Okay, so then there was also... there was a late night radio call-in show hosted by
Puff the Magic Dragon.
Puff the Magic Dragon calls into a late night radio call-in show for some advice.
And but who was calling? Or the, oh, it was the what was the name of the radio show, Catherine? The
Night Talk with Barry Champlain. Champlain for
oh, yeah,
Barry Champlain.
Oh, Champlain.
Yeah, yeah.
There was,
but, the and also that wasn't right because Puff is a lead character.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
He's not.
Was Cinderella. That was.
Yeah. That was, yeah.
Yeah. We really as they say in theater, we had to kill a lot of darlings because we were like,
there was one where Christopher Robin and Eeyore and Tigger have an intervention for Pooh because he's addicted to honey.
Yeah.
There was at a lawyer's office, they were reading through Mother's will and the recipients of the will were Dick and Jane.
Oh, Dick, yeah. They're run, Dick, go, Dick, go, and like they can
run, Dick, run, yeah.
Basic English. But
Barry, you had a fun thing with Stacy's mom or Jesse's girl or stupid pop songs.
It was Jeopardy. It was Jeopardy, and it was like all nameless women from popular music. Like
oh right, Jesse's girl and.
Hold on, I have it here.
Who are the other ones?
I can tell you.
Girl
from Ipanema.
Oh, the girl from Ipanema, yeah.
And Stacy's mom.
Stacy's mom, that's right.
Good. That's good.
And Stacy's mom.
That's good comedy.
Good comedy. It's
comedy.
Potentially haha, but got, you know.
Potentially.
Hey, who am I waving at right now?
Your dog. Alex. Matt.
Alex.
No. Oh, okay. That's Alex. Okay.
Wait, no, because I think all of ours are different.
No, you're on the bottom.
I'm on the top of mine.
No, but I think that my record, anyways. So that was great. Thank you guys for, we're losing it.
Something I wanted to say earlier, it was obviously the process of it was just a pleasure from tip to tail, you know, because it's just hanging out with you guys. And it was so satisfying to have our fun be structured. Like our fun begins at 9 a.m. and we'll take a break from fun for unstructured fun for 15 minutes at 11. And it just felt so good. And it's like suddenly our friendship is productive and the product.
Yeah.
You know,
it was really. I think you said this, Catherine. I remember like kind of saying like, you sort of saw that all you needed was a little bit structure and we were all collectively able to produce more than like you could ever imagine within those 6 days. I mean, like it is incredible that we did all that in 6 days.
Yeah.
With that, we're, thank you, the three of you for joining in on the fun. Hi to all of you out there that if you got this far in the conversation, bless you. Because
that's amazing for me.
Behind the scenes.
This could have gone a lot better.
No, how dare you? How dare you?
Wow.
Okay. Thanks everybody and goodbye.
Bye.
Juicy. When a fart sounds juicy and wet. What's that? That's not from your sweaty butt.
No, that's like moisture particles in the fart, like could be on its way to a shirt.
Could be.